All right. So yesterday we were talking about the resistance and capacitance corresponding to wire, right? And the main thing that we want to sort of get an idea for is what are the kinds of numbers involved over here and under what conditions can these become significant? Plus, how do you model them, right? How do you actually take into account these wires while actually simulating the system and trying to find out what delays and so on are? Okay. So one of the things that happens is effectively what any wire right which leads into some kind of a load can be modeled as some kind of a resistance and a capacitance, right? A combined resistance capacitance driving the same load. Right? So this is some kind of a RC model or equivalent of the wire. Right? And the question is, what kind of model should we use? And how do you actually model this wire as an equivalent resistance and capacitance so that it is reasonably accurate and you know gives you at least to the useful results from simulation. Okay? So now of course the first possible thing that we can do is to say I will just model it as single R2. Okay? Now this is not a very accurate model. In fact, it can be off by up to 50% as we actually saw in the case of the Elmore delay analysis, right? This is a very crude approximation. What you have done is taken the total resistance of the wire, taken the total capacitance offered by the wire and just put them as if equal. Okay? The other model that you can use is a so-called distributed L model. Right? Where what we do is they break this up into many segments and say that the overall end-to-end of this, from this input to this output, is the same as that on the wire. Right? Now, as n tends to infinity, this is the most accurate model that you can get. It accurately models the wire itself. Okay? It sort of says that the wire consists of many small segments which have a resistance and a capacitance of their own. Right? And therefore, as n tends to infinity, this is the more accurate model of the wire delay. Right? And if you use the Elmore formula over here, I think we went through this exercise in class. If not, you can just go through it and calculate what is the Elmore delay that you get as a result of going through this entire exercise. Take this wire, break it up into n segments, find the total delay through that, and then let n tend to infinity. Right? Take the limiting case. It turns out that the delay over here is RC by 2. Right? Whereas over here the Elmore delay is RC. Right? And this is wrong by quite a large margin. Because RC by 2 is a much more accurate estimate of what it actually is. Right? So one thing we can see is the distributed model with the L shape, that is the R and C in L pattern, can be made quite accurate provided you have sufficient number of segments. Okay? Now it turns out that there are a couple of other models which can also be used which essentially say instead of having the L model, we'll use a sort of phi model over here. Right? And this can also be done in many segments. It I have drawn it of course only for a single segment, but you can of course take this entire thing and say, I will take R and the C equivalent, break it up into R by N, and C by 2N, C by 2N distributed on each side. Okay? Now, the point is, even though this looks like a very tiny difference, it turns out that it is much more accurate in simulation. We need fewer segments in order to get the same level of accuracy using this pi model. Okay? There is also another model. It is called a T model, where the R is broken. And the pi model is much more accurate for small n than the T model, than the L model. Okay? You can see that straight away, even with a single segment, essentially the Elmore delay that would be given by the pi model is R into C by 2, not R into C. Right? Because you will essentially be seeing the delay from here up to this point. And that comes R into C by 2. So, just to get an idea of what this is, let's look at an example. This is again from the text, right? We have a metal 2 wire which is 5 millimeters long and 0.32 micron wide. Okay? So what does this mean? Does it mean it's a long wire? Five millimeters, 5,000 microns. Okay, so this is not just used for connecting between a couple of gates. It is the kind of wire which probably runs pretty much across the length of the chip. Okay, of course nowadays chips can be even larger. You can have a chip which is 10 by 10 or even 20 by 20 mm. So 5 millimeters is not necessarily an extreme case. It is definitely a possibility in modern technology. Okay. The thickness on the other hand is metal 2 and this is the minimum. That is the 320 nanometer minimum width that is allowed for a wire. Now that is rare. Usually when you have such long wires, you will also make them a bit wider. Right? Because you don't want such a long wire to be just running with a high value of resistance. But anyway, for the sake of the example, let's just go through with this. Okay? So what is the resistance of this wire? It's going to be given by the R square into L by W. Okay? And the R square for the metal 2 wire from the numbers that I gave yesterday is 0.05 ohm per square. Into L is 5000, W is 0.32 micron. Okay? So this works out to about 781 ohms. Okay? So you can see that it's possible for just a wire alone to have a resistance in the region of a kilo ohm, even though it's made of metal. Right? The region is so narrow. Right, the width is minimum. If it had been on one of the higher metal layers, then the R per square would have been much less. The W would have been more. Okay? So overall the resistance would have been significantly lower. But on the other hand, this is what we have. Okay. What about the capacitance? This is going to be given by C per micron. Into the length. Okay, so that was 0.2 femtofarad per micron into 5000 micron. Okay, so 1000 femtofarad or 1 picofarad. Okay, so you see this this is huge, right? The normal capacitances that we have talked about so far while talking about gates have been in the range of 1 to 10 femtofarads. Right? Now you are talking about a single wire which has a capacitance of 1 picofarad. Right? 1000 times of a femtofarad. Right? So this is definitely going to be a major problem when you try driving this. So let's sort of estimate what would be the delay if we had some kind of a gate going through this wire and driving another gate. Okay? And the specific example that we can take up is, this is a size 10 inverter, this is a size 2 inverter. Okay? What a size 10 means? It means basically 3.6 micron of width, okay, for the NMOS. Because 0.36 is the minimum width of the NMOS, 10 times means 3.6 is the width of the NMOS, 7.2 microns is the width of the PMOS. Right? Over here it is 0.72 micron NMOS and correspondingly 1.44 micron PMOS. Okay? So, in order to do this, we would essentially be estimating what is the rise and fall delay due to the, or rather the resistance and the capacitance due to the NMOS itself. Okay? So, I am going to, for the time being, neglect the parasitic capacitance of this driving inverter. Okay, we'll see later that, yeah, it doesn't really make much of a difference. For the time being, we'll just neglect it completely. Okay? So then what becomes important is, this can be modeled either as a PMOS pull-up or a NMOS pull-down. Okay? And the question that comes is, what is the equivalent resistance of that pull-up or pull-down? Now, again, a number for this is given by the fact that the resistance is approximately 2.5 kilo ohm micron. Okay? What do I mean by that? It means that the resistance for minimum size, NMOS, is going to be given by 2.5 kilo ohm micron divided by the W, 0.36 micron. Okay? This would be the equivalent resistance. This is around 6900 ohms. This is for a unit NMOS. Okay? And the corresponding PMOS in the inverter would also have the same resistance because it would be double the width. Right? But has half the mobility. Okay. So the equivalent resistance of this inverter is essentially going to be 6900 ohms. Which means that for a 10x inverter, R is going to be given by 6900 divided by 10 or 690 ohms. Right? What about the capacitance? 2 femtofarads per micron into PMOS plus NMOS W, because the capacitance for both adds up. Right? Which means that for minimum size, going to be 1.08 micron. For the 2x inverter, this is going to be 2.16 micron. Right? Or the input capacitance is going to be 4.32 microns, approximately 4 microns, let's say. Okay. So now what does our model for the delay look like? We have a large inverter driving a long wire, driving another inverter. Okay. The driver looks like 690 ohms going either to ground or to VDD. So essentially it doesn't matter. This is the source for the Elmo delay calculation. Right? Some model of the wire and a capacitance of 4 femtofarads, that is it. Okay? And what does the wire have? We did those calculations as well. 781 ohms and 1 picofarad. Okay. Now, as we said, the sort of more accurate way or the slightly more accurate model for this is the pi model rather than the L model. So let's replace that wire with a pi model equivalent. Right? So what does it look like? The driving resistance is 690 ohms. The pi model of this will take 500 picofarads and put it here, or rather 500 femtofarads and put it here. The R will go over there. And the load capacitance of 4 femtofarads over here. Right? So you can see straight away that when you compare these two, the load in this case is actually insignificant compared to the wire capacitance. Right? And what happens to actual calculation itself is going to be given by R1 plus R2 C2, right? Because of the shared part. So the 690 times 0.5 picofarad and 690 plus 781 times 504 femtofarad. Okay. Yeah. This is for which? Per micron, 2 femtofarads per micron of gate width. Right? The capacitance, the input capacitance of a gate is approximately 2 femtofarads per micron of gate width, not per unit NMOS. So unit NMOS is only 0.36 microns. So the input capacitance of that is 2 into 0.36 microns. But for an inverter, you have the NMOS as well as the PMOS. Right? So the NMOS is 0.36 microns. The PMOS is 0.72 microns, the total is 1.08, close to 1. So, the effective input capacitance of the inverter becomes 2 femtofarads. That's all. Okay? So, if you go ahead with this calculation, you will find that this is approximately 1.1 nanoseconds. Right? Now the important part is this almost entirely has been dominated by the capacitance of the wire itself, not the load. Okay. Now if you wanted a slightly more accurate computation, then what you need to do is take the load 690 ohms, replace the wire by let's say a 3-segment pi model. Okay. So what does a 3-segment pi model mean? It means that the total resistance of 780 ohms is going to be split among three resistances. there will be 260 point something. Okay, and the capacitance, the overall capacitance of 1 picofarad, I take it and divide it into 3 parts, 333 each. But those 333 itself gets split like this. 167 here, 167 here, well 166.5, whatever, doesn't matter. And finally the load capacitance of 4 femtofarad. Right. Now this model would have been slightly more accurate, in which case what you would have done is club these two together and got 333 femtofarad over here. Club these two together to get 333 femtofarad over here. Okay. The only point is we would have still got a number close to 1.1 nanoseconds, but this would be a more accurate computation. And it turns out that typically a 3 segment pi model is sufficient to within around 3 to 5% of the final result. Okay. So if you wanted a more accurate calculation rather than just a single, so this model, what we have done over here, is a single stage pi model. Right? It is accurate but not that accurate, because you have essentially lumped all of the resistance together into one block. Right? And the capacitance also you just split it into two. A more accurate model would be a 3 segment pi model like this. Here again you have more stages as far as the Elmore delay is concerned. When you do the final calculation, you will get a similar number. Right? Maybe not 1.1 nanosecond, something slightly different from that, but a slightly more accurate number is what you will get. Okay? Alright. So that is our estimate of the total delay that you can get through a long wire. Okay. Now another important effect that comes in because of these wires and their capacitances is this concept of crosstalk. Okay. So crosstalk happens when you have two wires and the coupling capacitance between them. Right? So effectively what is happening is there is some kind of a capacitance between these two wires. Right? And that capacitance is going to cause, when one wire switches, the other wire is also going to get affected. Okay? Let's consider sort of the worst case. So what we have over here is, we have two wires, we call them A and B. A switches from 0 to 1, consider B is floating, right? In this case, in the worst case, what can happen is you can actually have up to, waveform can look something like this. The A waveform goes up this way, right? And the B waveform can actually also significantly increase because of the fact that B was floating. How is this determined? The amount of delta V that you have over here is related to the C adjacent, right? And the C ground. The fact that there is an adjacent capacitance, the line-to-line capacitance, and also the fact that there is another capacitance from each of the lines to ground, okay? Both of those should be sort of determining factors in how much this delta V can turn out to be. Okay? If V is floating, that is to say it is not being driven actively by any line, this number can be fairly significant. Okay? it can be quite large. It can be even up to 50% or so of the total thing, right? So what is happening here? Since we have two wires which are running parallel to each other, one of them is switching from 0 to 1, the other one has been left floating, so there is no gate driving it. Right? What we are saying is just because of the fact that there is a capacitance between them, it's possible for that floating wire to show an increase in voltage which is quite significant. The delta V can be even up to VDD by 2 or so. Right? Why is that happening? Because there is a capacitance and there is nothing else on the floating wire which is trying to pull it either to VDD or to ground. Okay? Now, in practice, this does not usually happen. What you are going to have is, there will be one wire here another wire here. Okay? What is going to end up happening is this one switches. This one stays constant. Let's say at zero. Okay? Now there is still a capacitance between these two. Right? And because of the fact that there is a capacitance between these two, that can cause some amount of change in the voltage on B, on the wire for B. Right? But because of the fact that B is being actively driven to zero, it will not cause the voltage to just randomly go all the way up to VDD by 2, but you can still see some kind of a voltage which goes, supposing this is A, B will go something like this. Okay? Now, in extreme cases, this can be a very prominent effect. It can cause a fairly large shift depending on the relative strengths of the two gates. Okay? Supposing A was a much stronger gate driving more current and B was a relatively weak gate. Right? It's not able to drive the wire as strongly as A is able to. Okay? Then because of that coupling capacitance, it's quite possible that because of A switching from 0 to 1, B will also show a fairly significant change in its voltage. Okay? Now that voltage could be positive as in this case, or it could even go negative, it can go below the range. Right? It can cause the voltage at B to drop below 0. Right? If the switching that was happening on the other side was in the other direction, from 1 to 0. Okay? Now, usually what happens is the gates that we have are active restoring logic gates. So, they will take care of switching the voltage back to a proper logic level. Right? But temporarily, this can actually look almost like a glitch. That is a wrong transition on the net. Okay? And in some cases, especially for something like dynamic logic, it can actually cause the circuit to go completely wrong. Right? Because in dynamic logic, supposing you have had a transition from 0 to 1, after that there is no recovering from it. So if you show a temporary transition from 0 to 1 and say delta V is greater than the threshold voltage of the next NMOS transistor, it will start causing the stage to discharge. After some time it goes back down to 0, but that's too late. The stage is already discharged, then the output is no longer at a logic height that it should have been. Okay? So this crosstalk can become fairly significant when you have large amounts of logic which are all close to each other. Or when you have long wires with high capacitance that are running parallel to each other. Right? Now can you think of any scenario where such a situation might be common, that you have such long wires which are running parallel to each other and are transitioning at more or less the same time? Can you think of a scenario where something like this can happen? Huh? Metal layers, yes, but what kind of wires? I mean, if I just have random logic, let's say I have a bunch of AND gates, OR gates and so on, then their signals are all going to be slightly disconnected from each other, right? They won't all be transitioning at the same time. Clock is one possibility. But then the clock is just one signal on its own, right? But it's definitely a signal with a very high capacitance. So if the clock signal goes close to any other line, it is definitely going to have a significant amount of this capacitive coupling effect on whatever the other line is. The other possibility that can happen is buses. Right? So let's say I have a memory bus, a data bus or an address bus. Right? I have something like 8 or 16 wires all running in parallel to each other and all transitioning more or less at the same time. Okay? So when one is trying to go from 0 to 1, another one might be trying to go from 1 to 0, they will have sort of opposing effects on each other. So neither of the signals will go as quickly as it should have. Right? So what will happen in other words is, supposing I have a transition of this sort. Right? So A is supposed to go high, B is supposed to go low. What will end up happening is, one of them will get delayed, or both of them might get delayed, because they are not able to transition as quickly as they should have before. Right? The delta V, the coupling effect between them causes both of them to sort of slow down slightly. And it can cause an increase in delay. So as a result of the crosstalk, you can actually end up with timing failures which are almost impossible to predict otherwise, because you could not have predicted it by doing a static timing analysis. Yeah. No, so that is assuming that you can pull it up. But supposing I am just using address lines driven by logic. Okay? They are not floating. They are driven by some gate. I am applying address line to memory. After some time I want to change that. So I cannot just pull everything up to 1. I have to keep it at some 010 whatever it was, and from there go to 101. Right? So it has a set of Boolean binary values on it. From there it is switching to another set of binary values. In between I cannot pull everything up. Okay? Under that condition, this will directly cause a switching problem. That is, one of them is trying to go from 0 to 1, another one is trying to go from 1 to 0. Both will sort of counteract each other's effect and will cause each other to go more slowly. So it can cause a delay increase. Okay. Okay, so that's pretty much it as far as crosstalk is concerned. The last sort of topic that I want to talk about, once again, is slightly descriptive in the sense that there are a few different issues that we need to discuss over here. Right? It's not exactly things where you can solve problems, but well, they are important concepts to know. Okay? That is related to the overall problem of reliability. Okay? Reliability is essentially a study of how reliable or how well a circuit is going to work in practice and what is the chance of it failing. Okay? So by itself a circuit, I mean I build a circuit, I want to test it out. What are the chances of it failing? Any one of the components that are made inside it, that are used inside it, if they fail for whatever reason, right? Then the circuit is likely to fail. It's likely to give me a wrong output. So why am I saying likely to? Because there might be situations where it will also give you the correct output. Maybe only one particular transition, 0 to 1 or 1 to 0, one of those is going wrong. The other one still works. Right? But as far as I'm concerned, that's still a failing circuit. Okay. So now the question becomes, how do we analyze this? If I'm just building one circuit and I'm just interested in, is that working correctly or not? But typically in IC design, that's not what we are doing. What we are doing is designing a circuit once and then building it thousands or millions of times. Okay? So it's not enough that one particular circuit works. Million copies of that circuit or 10 million or 100 million copies have to work correctly. Okay? And so the question becomes, what is the chance or how do you sort of analyze these kind of failures? Ultimately what happens is there are certain types of failures which no matter how careful you are with the process, there is no way to prevent. Right? They are just random events. In the worst case, it could be an alpha particle strike. Okay, some radiation from somewhere, a cosmic ray or something like comes along, hits some part of your manufacturing process and disrupts one particular step. right? This can actually happen. So if something of that sort of happens, it's nearly impossible to predict, and it is impossible to sort of make sure that the circuit is 100% reliable under all conditions. Okay? What do you do instead? You essentially design it to be as reliable as possible. If you suspect that it is going to be unreliable, then you put extra duplicate circuits over there that will do the work for you. Right? Try and reduce the probability of the circuit going wrong as much as possible. Okay? So, in this context, there is some terminology that is typically used. Right? There is a concept of mean time between failures. And a related concept of the fit rate. Failures in time. Okay? Now the fit is effectively something which is calculated in this way. It is the number of failures divided by number of failures per 1000 hours of operation per million devices that are manufactured. Okay, so what does this mean? Let's say that I make 1 million chips. Operate them for 1000 hours all of them, all 1 million of them I operate them for 1000 hours, there is only one failure. That is one thing. So one failure among 10 to the power of 9 device hours of operation. Okay? It could also have been that I had 1000 chips and I ran them for 1 million hours. But 1 million hours is like 100 years or so. Okay? So you can't really run it for that long. Okay? So it's meaningless to talk about running something for 1 million hours. But on the other hand, 1 million devices for 1000 hours is easy. 1000 hours is just about 40 days. Right? So, it is definitely possible to think about something running for 1000 hours. And since we are making devices in the millions, this fit rate is taken to be in the 10 power 9. Right? So, one failure in 10 power 9 device hours of operation is considered one fit. One failure in 10. Okay? Now, let's say that I have one chip of 1000 chips. If I just take that chip, operate it and look for and wait for it to fail, what it's saying is that the average time that I would be waiting for it to fail would be 10 power 6 hours. To failure. Right? This is more than 100 years. But supposing I have one system, right, with 100 chips on it. So it's a printed circuit board with 100 different chips on it. Right? My assumption is that if any one of those chips fails, the system has failed. What happens to the fit rate? It multiplies. Right? So if any one of them had a fit rate of 1000 chips, the next one also had a fit rate of 1000 chips, right? Then effectively, sorry, not multiply, but it multiplies by the number of devices that I have, right? So it will become 2000 chips, right? If I have 100 such chips, it will become 100 into 1000, 100,000 chips, okay? This means 10 to the power of 4 hours to failure. Right? This is approximately 1.5 years. But let's say that I make 100 of these devices. The chance of at least one of them failing within 100 hours is high. Okay? Now this part of it is necessarily a little bit vague. It is not an exact probability that I am giving. I am not giving you like 95% probability that it is going to fail. Right? So these numbers, the fit rates, are a sort of rough measure of what you can expect to be the failure rate. In reality, they will be defined a bit more precisely. So you can sort of say that what is the probability that a certain device is going to fail, or that any one of these devices is going to fail within 100 hours. And you should be able to estimate that. Right? The fit rates are a sort of crude way of estimating the same thing, but something that can be done very easily by just hand calculating. Okay? So effectively all of this is talking about the reliability of the system. Now think about a company like Samsung, which is building cell phones. Right? Let's say they sell 1 million copies of some cell phone, their latest Galaxy A series or whatever it is. Inside that cell phone, there are going to be a large number of chips. At the very least 10 chips, probably more like 100 chips. Okay? So 10 power 6 devices, 100 chips inside those devices, so 10 power 8. Even if they are able to reduce the fit rate of each individual device to something like 100 chips, which is quite difficult to do, right? You have 10 power 10 as the fit rate, which basically means about 10 devices failing every hour. Okay? What do I mean by a failure? Failure could be anything. It could be something as small as one particular signal somewhere in the system going wrong. So let's say one of your phones, right, out of 1 million that you have bought one of the phones. There's a good chance that within a few hours itself, something goes wrong with it. The power is not working the way that you expected. It's not charging. Something happens and there's one pixel wrong somewhere on the screen. Right? Any one of those 100 chips that are being used over there could have one small mistake. That's considered a failure. Right? So then what can people do? They can also sort of grade these as different kinds of failure. Some which are complete catastrophic. Some which, you know, the thing doesn't boot at all. Some which are relatively minor, one pixel is dead on the screen. Right, you hardly notice it. So those kind of things are different levels of failure which can be graded. But as far as the estimation itself is concerned, you can have a fairly high level of, high rate of failure, and you can estimate that by knowing the fit rates of the individual components used in the device. Okay? Now, the last thing essentially is, okay, and a related thing to this, there is also something called the bathtub curve. Right? What that says is, once you manufacture devices, typically, and all of these are not really, you know, they are not the science of IC design, it's more the engineering aspect. Right? What happens in practice? In practice, when you design IC, typically what happens is there is a very large initial failure rate. Okay, so this is the failure rate over time. Right? What happens is initially there is a very high failure rate. That is because of a couple of reasons. One is that many devices, as soon as you switch them on, they have some kind of initial problem which are aggravated just by sort of turning on the power. Okay? On top of that, there is also something called a burn-in test that is typically done to every device. That is, you take the device and run it at a slightly higher voltage and higher temperature than is normally expected to sort of force it to sort of see if it will age quickly and whether there will be some problem with it. So this causes a large number of failures initially. After that, it settles down to a low level of failure. Then eventually, as time goes on, after a certain amount of time, the number of failures starts increasing once again. Right? So this initial part is called the infant mortality. This is called the regular lifetime. And this is considered the aging or wear off. Right? Now you might be wondering, digital circuits or circuits in general don't have any moving parts. So how can they wear out with time? Right? The main reason for it, there are a number of reasons, and in fact even though they have no moving parts, there are phenomena, there's something called electromigration. Right? What happens in the case of electromigration is, supposing you have a wire with a DC current flowing through it. Eventually what will happen is this will actually cause movement of metal atoms. Right? So it becomes thinner after a while and can eventually break. Right? So especially when you have high DC current flowing in a single direction, it can cause a continuous sort of eventual slow gradual movement of metal atoms from one side to another, eventually causing the wire to break. So even though there are no moving parts as such, it can still cause problems as far as the lifetime of the system is concerned. Okay? A related effect is the self-heating. Even though there is no DC current which is flowing only in one direction, any current that flows through a wire causes a certain amount of heat. Right? Because of the resistive dissipation. I square R law. Right? Given enough time, that can actually cause portions of the wire to effectively melt. Right? Or become thinner in a certain area. That can cause actual physical damage to the wire itself over time. Okay? Then there is a concept of something called hot carrier. Right? What happens in this is, the carriers which are present in the channel of the transistor are themselves fairly energetic, and you are applying a further electric field to them to make them flow. Okay? Some of those carriers over time will go into the oxide layer, right, the insulating oxide, and get trapped over there. What is the effect of that? It's as though you have implanted an ion in the oxide. You can change the threshold voltage. Okay? Which means that over time, as more and more of these hot carriers go and get embedded in that oxide layer, the threshold voltage changes and the current that can be delivered by the device, whether it's NMOS or PMOS, changes with time. Okay? So these are some of the effects that are there. There are other things. There is something called the negative bias temperature instability, or NBTI. This is also related to the hot carrier effect. All of these effects are, even though there are no moving parts as such in a circuit, they are things which can cause physical damage and can cause the circuit to fail over time. Some of these effects, like hot carriers and all that, you can actually simulate their effects during burn-in test by running it at a higher voltage. You can sort of anticipate what is going to be the effect of these carriers or these kind of defects. And sort of, you know, work, get them into the system so that they don't later on come in and cause problems by changing the behavior of the circuit. Okay? There are a few other different kinds of reliability problems as well. Most of these are studied under the context of reliability in circuits. Okay? There are certain issues such as how do you test circuits, how do you sort of design for reliability, how do you design for good manufacturability and so on, which I am not touching upon at all as far as this course is concerned. Those are all topics that you can look up later if you find them interesting. Right? These are more sort of just pointers saying that such things exist. They could be of potentially of interest to some of you. If you find them interesting, then please do go ahead and look at them in more detail. Okay. Alright, so with that we come to the end of the course. right? Like I said, on Friday we will have a overall review class. On Monday also if necessary. But what I would request all of you is, if you have any specific areas that you want to be touched upon in more detail, then please let me know either by email or by dropping a note somewhere in my office or something like that. Let me know that this needs to be done, right? So that I can cover those topics in a little bit more detail in the classes that are coming. Right? The final exam, of course, is as scheduled. Please look up the institute calendar. It's going to be held on the date that has been mentioned. Hopefully, all of the assignments you have got the graded results back by now. Please check your marks also for the quiz 1 and quiz 2. Right? They are uploaded on the Moodle link, so you should be able to see your marks. Please check your marks and confirm that they are in fact correct. If there is any discrepancy, let the TAs know as soon as possible so that they can correct it. Okay? Alright. Sorry? Assignment? Okay. So some of the assignments are still to be graded. They will be done within the next few days, definitely. Right? So hopefully by Friday you should be having the marks. Why? Right.